Hey, I'm Zach, a researcher on large language model agents. We all know agents are the future, but are you still coding them by hand? If large language model agents are truly helpful, why can't they just build us agents for us? Today, I want to share a new paradigm where you can let large language model agents build us agents for you. For example, you can simply chat with Cursor AI agents by describing the agents you want to build, and Cursor AI will handle the heavy lifting of designing those agents and writing the code for you. In the next 10 minutes, you will learn about PocketFlow, an extremely flexible 100-line framework for building any agent you want, and how combining PocketFlow with Cursor empowers Cursor AI agents to automatically build us agents. Let's dive right in. So what's PocketFlow? It's a large language model framework that's only 100 lines of code. It's open source, and you can find the link in the description. Essentially, it's a Python library that defines nodes, creates graphs, and has some extensions. So you might be wondering, why use a graph? It turns out that graphs are extremely flexible. You can build all sorts of agents, workflow chaining, retrieval augmented generation, and more on top of graphs. Let me break down the key ideas. First, there are nodes. A node is the basic compute unit. It can call large language models, embed tasks, or invoke external tools, basically anything you need. Next is batching. A node can also run in batch mode, which is handy if you want to process multiple inputs at once. For instance, you can embed multiple chunks of a large file one by one. Then there are flows. You can turn multiple nodes into a workflow represented as a graph. So here we created a retrieval augmented generation flow that first embed text, then retrieve the most relevant text, and finally call large language models to answer the question based on the retrieved text. Finally, there's the shared store. All nodes communicate through a shared store, which can be anything from an in-memory object to a relational database. You might be wondering, where did this framework even come from? And how do we know it's actually helpful? Let me share the backstory. PocketFlow started off as a personal hack, basically my attempt to let large language model agents build us agents for me. I spent the past few years as a researcher working on over 10 different AI projects and published multiple papers. Throughout the process, each project involved hundreds of iterative tweaks, and all this trial and error was extremely time-consuming and laborious. That made me wonder, if large language model agents are truly helpful, why can't we use agents to help me build us agents? So Cursor AI caught my attention when it came out last year because it offered a new programming paradigm. Just chat with the AI, and it will help you build projects. However, when I tried using Cursor with frameworks like LangChain to build agents, it didn't work. These frameworks are very large, and Cursor often have trouble understanding them. It would hallucinate or make mistakes as the problem gets complex. I find that Cursor works surprisingly well with a smaller, simpler framework. Over the year, I created a small framework to build my own agent, which only contains a graph and a shared store abstraction. When Cursor was released, I tested it with my framework, and it worked extremely well. Cursor AI immediately clicked with the framework, understood what it is for, and began building agents on its own. I've been refining it ever since, and it has significantly improved my own productivity over the past year. So during the last Christmas holiday, I was stuck long and couldn't visit my family because of visa issues. So I decided to use that time to turn my small framework into a standalone project. After refactoring the codes, I realized that it only needed 100 lines of code to work, so there's no need for large packagers with massive folders and files. I published the projects on GitHub and shared it on Reddit, where it gained much more attention than I expected. Within about a month, it had received hundreds of upvotes and nearly 500 stars on GitHub, and that's the backstory of the framework. Next, let's jump into a quick demo to show you how these 100 lines of codes let Cursor AI agents build agents themselves. So let's start by setting up Cursor with PocketFlow. We are on the Cursor, and to let Cursor AI agent work smoothly with PocketFlow, they need the right context. To achieve that, you will need to create a file called Cursor Rules that includes the documentation for PocketFlow. We have already prepared the file for you. Simply click on the PocketFlow GitHub repository, and you can find the Cursor Rule file here. Once that's set up, you can test it by asking Cursor, give me a quick introduction to PocketFlow. Cursor will then use the documentation we provided to generate an explanation. Next, let's prepare utility functions. These are helper functions like calling large language models, generating text embeddings, or invoking external APIs. PocketFlow doesn't include these utilities by default because it's designed to stay minimal. However, Cursor AI can help fill the gap. You can just ask Cursor, help me implement a call large language model function that gets a response from OpenAI models. Also provide a function to get embeddings from text. So here are the two functions it generates. Let's use our OpenAI key and test it out. As you can see here, it has successfully called the large language models and embedded the texts. Now let's cover nodes in PocketFlow. A node is the smallest unit of work in PocketFlow. It has three steps. It performs pre-processing, which means it reads or retrieves data from the shared store. It executes a task which might involve calling a large language model or generating embeddings. It does post-processing, which means it writes results back to the shared store. For example, we have some program hub essays in this directory. We can then ask Cursor AI to create a node that summarizes one essay in 50 words. So let's run and take a look at these codes. In the pre-processing steps, it reads the original text from the shared store. In the execution steps, it calls the large language model to summarize the text into 50 words. Then in the post-processing steps, it writes the result back into the shared store, and we can confirm the final summary by printing out the shared store again. Batch node function very similar to node, but instead of operating on a single file, it operates on multiple files. So for its pre-processing steps, instead of returning a single item, it returns a list of items. Then the execution step is called once for each of the items in the list. So for example, you can ask Cursor AI to help me implement a batch node that summarizes all the program hub essays in the directory, and Cursor will build such a batch node. Let's run the codes, but the key difference here is that the pre-processing step takes a list of items and returns a list of results. The post-processing steps also get the list of items and the list of execution results as input, and we can see that it loads the whole directory, performs the summarization for each file, and prints the results one by one. Finally, we have flows. A flow connects your nodes in a graph-like structure, so you can chain nodes together to break down complex problems into simpler ones, or branch out based on agentic actions written by a node's post method. Typically, you define a flow specifying the start node and then calling the run function to kick it off. Flows can be nested, branched, or just a simple sequence of nodes. So let's ask Cursor, help me implement a retrieval augmented generation chatbot that, given a user's input questions, finds the most relevant program hub essay based on embeddings and then answers the user's question. The output may look complex at first, but it's actually very simple. We have three nodes, prepare embeddings that reads all the files from the directory and embeds them into a vector database. Find the relevant documents, which given a user questions, and search for the most relevant files based on the embed similarity. Answer questions, which uses the retrieved file as the context for the large language model to generate an answer. Now let's run the codes, and we can also ask the question, how do you find a good startup ideas? The results suggest that a good startup idea should emerge unconsciously rather than through forced efforts, and also the response links back to the essay that provided the advice. So that concludes this tutorial. Hopefully this simple example shows you how we can use large language model agents to build agents for us, and why a minimal framework is the key. I plan to create more tutorial videos covering more complex and hopefully more interesting use cases. So if there's anything specific you would love to see, please leave a comment. See you next time.